take 2 minutes of time to explain on the subject of this presentation. So the idea behind the whole objective and what we are currently doing is to understand, given a particular problem set, instead of applying just the principles and the ideas which we all know or what we call as bookish knowledge, instead of just applying that blindly, what is a pragmatic approach or a more practical approach which businesses should adopt in order to be more having a more realistic approach to a problem solving, to a problem statement, and then solving the problem with ease and with the consideration that the business will be likely to scale up. So with that in mind, allow me to share my screen. So very quickly, I don't want this to be a company-based presentation. We are a small startup. I'll just take 1 minute of time to explain what we do and what is the genesis. So primarily, we are headquartered in California, but most of our operations is in India. And we help businesses, be it small SME, MSME, or a large enterprise, to transform intelligent transform with the resources that they have and transform in a more sustainable manner. So there is a connotation which comes with AI and machine learning and all these emerging technologies, especially into automation. People, yeah, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, I thought somebody, okay, in the meanwhile, if anyone has any questions, any queries, I'll take it at the end of the session, but if you feel like there is a pressing need to address that, feel free to, you know, question me. Now, as I was mentioning, the key area which we have understood in terms of addressing these business problem is that every organization has a culture which gets disrupted when you introduce an emerging technology. So most of the companies, they have fear. They fear the introduction of these technologies within their setup. So with AI, they feel like, okay, if my processes are going to get automated, my resources will become redundant. If my processes will come through, then whatever learning my employees or my colleagues have had, that will be taken care by a machine. So the fight becomes between a machine and a man, and that is how we equate it. It's not the machine which is thinking in, on those lines, because it is how we implement the machine in a business setup. Now, the whole idea here is, I have always said and I have always endorsed that wherever you will find that people are talking about AI, they'll put a human brain. And they'll say that, you know, AI is cognitive and that is the depiction. I, in my presentation or wherever I see that, I am totally, you know, against it. So human cognizance can never be replaced by machines. That's the first thing. The second thing is that, so what we try to bring in through AI and machine learning and other emerging technologies is an ease of taking away the mundane task or the repetitive task, which are done by enterprises without, you know, too much of head banging or too much of thought process into it. So let's say every day within a company, like any XYZ company, which is based out of Bangalore or anywhere in India, all the employees will be coming at, let's say, I'm taking the login time as 9 o'clock. They'll be switching on the system, right? Now imagine an AI-based program which can understand that, okay, it's 9 o'clock, or a scheduler-based program, simple scheduler without any AI or machine learning built into it. And it knows that at 9 o'clock, you have to switch on a system. And that is the simplest way in which you can imagine an automated task which got executed on that day. Now, without, I'll show you the other implications and how we build the models and the various aspects from a a problem statement to the final solutioning. This is very important to understand and make, let's say, even the students or even the professors who are seeking an enterprise journey to be aware that what is going on in the market and how I should think, what should be my thought process to be more relevant in the market. And this is very important. So very quickly, the market size in terms of AI and machine learning based intelligent automation. Now, what we call as intelligent automation is actually any process which is automated and has inbuilt AI and machine learning into it with an RPA. Now, what is RPA? RPA is robotic process automation. So it comes with an underlying engine on top of which the whole process or the business logic runs through. Now, I'll give other examples, but what we have seen in the global market, the biggest industry which has got intelligent automation adopted within itself is financial services. So we are talking about BFSI, which is the first. Second is a lot of government agencies, they are also endorsing AI, particularly in terms of education sector and also in terms of bringing in various processes which can automate the immigration laws. And then it's manufacturing, supply chain, human resources. But the more critical functions are BFSI and healthcare and manufacturing, because they are using intelligent automation as a means to take real-time decisions. Now, what is the real problem because of which companies adopt AI and machine learning and such initiatives? The real problem is that companies or businesses want to achieve the impossible. Now, what is the impossible? Impossible is with minimum resources, how you can scale up and you can gain maximum traction in terms of your business growth. Now, for doing that, what is essentially required is to unlock the store value, which is there in terms of your digital transformation journey. Now, we have seen that there are basically three categories of companies within the industry at this point of view, at this point of time, from the view that there is a company which would like to adopt AI, but they don't know how to go about that journey. The second is a company which knows how to adopt AI and they know how to go about the journey, but they don't know where to start from. And the third is where they don't know either of the two things. So in all this, how can you create a solutioning which is, I would say, which can be used as a means to help businesses simplify their problem statement and at the same time address it? Now, the first thing is to break down this complex problem, and I'll take you through the methodology, and there is a framework which we follow, which we have created on our own. I have endorsed it, and this is something which is followed in the manufacturing domain as well. By the way, we are bootstrapped, and that is the objective of our organization, that we would like to be self-dependent, self-reliant, without depending on external funding. So that is the impossible task at hand, that with minimum resources, you want to scale up. The second thing is that you have understood as a business that AI is the means to do it. Now, how to do it? So let's say any structured, unstructured, any document set, most of the businesses can be divided into four different aspects. So either you have a document in play, or you have a video in play, or you have some sort of audio in play, or you have a whole process which is driven by a manual intervention or by an automated task. So these are the four different aspects. So in terms of the solutioning, I'll tell you what is the manifestation of that. But what we try to do is we try to understand one problem at a time. So we break a complex business problem, one problem at a time, and then we address that particular problem instead of taking the whole solutioning one at a go. So what it helps you to do is to reimage your business. It helps you to overcome the competition which is there in the market. with by doing this? It simplifies, and at the same time, you are able to scale up. You are able to derive growth and at the same time create newer opportunities for yourself and your business, and also scale up in the sense that it is sustainable. And that is very important. Now, very quickly, how we essentially do this. So imagine that a typical problem within an organization is that they would like to streamline their supply chain. Now, take that as, you know, you can see here there are three building blocks. So imagine there are three big, one bigger problem, one a bit smaller, and then the last one, the smallest problem out of that. So it's a combination of three such problems which are there with an organization, which is making it complex. Now, how we demystify this problem statement is by understanding that each of these problem statements can be addressed one at a time. So let's say one of the problems within your supply chain is that you would like to match a vendor, you would match a requirement with the right sort of vendor in terms of nearness. So let's say there is a company called as Bosch sitting in Bangalore, and they would like to procure nuts and bolts. Simple use case. Now there is a choice that company can either procure it from Bangalore itself or anywhere in India itself, or from Germany, or from any other location across the globe. Now, what is that factor which will determine from where they should procure it? So it is your historical data. It is your requirement. So you have a clear mandate that I need these many nuts and bolts to be there in 3 months of time, or let's say in 3 weeks of time. Now, there is a time requirement, there is a quantity requirement, and then comes the pricing. So taking all this into consideration and the historical data, let's say your procurement would have procured similar nuts and bolts from different service providers or vendors. The machine learning or the AI piece can actually determine at this point of time from where you should procure it, given the cost of logistics and transportation and the economics and the viability of the product being there. So this is how exactly, let's say, this intelligent piece of function, which we call as AI block, can solve a problem. Now, what is an AI block? An AI block is simply put, a lot of people ask me that, you know, you guys talk about AI block, but what is it? So we say that just like a problem statement can be a collection of different Lego blocks. So you during childhood, you would have played Lego as a game. Now, all these different pieces can be given a meaningful structure using an AI block. So what we do is we demystify this problem statement. We take one AI block at a time. AI block is basically a piece of Java program or a program which is built on, you can imagine, also on .NET. And we embed the AI and machine learning cognitive capability in terms of object detection, or in terms of also in terms of other OCR capabilities or other processing capabilities, together with, let's say, it could be a combination of a bot also. Now, what it helps us is it helps to create a enterprise friendly environment where you are addressing one problem at a time. So you are not disrupting the whole ecosystem of the company, which is there, because you're taking one problem at a time. So when you are dealing with this data, we will just look to have the procurement data, historical procurement data, and the current data. And this all happens outside the system where we ideate and we create a solution. So it helps in providing a nimble solution, which can run as a thin client. And subsequently, what we do is we project this as a industry orthogonal solution, because most of the industry, they do OCR for, let's say, a document processing, or they take the whole problem at a time, because you will hear about solutions like Automation Anywhere, Blue Prism, UiPath in the world of automation. essentially what they are doing is they are giving the whole platform to help businesses automate themselves. But that is an approach which is viable when you have a big setup, when you know exactly what is your problem, because essentially you are required to also code and to come out with the right sort of solution. Instead of that, what we do is we provide a customized solution to a given problem. So it helps in easily repurposing. So let's say if I have a solution which is for a KYC, let's say I'm processing the PAN and Aadhaar card using the images, and I'm extracting the data from PAN and Aadhaar of a customer. Now, if I would like to have a similar solution for, let's say, a company which is into vehicle loans, so there essentially I'll require to have driving license as one of the essential data set to be able to extract the essential information from a driving license. Now, what we do is we repurpose the same AI block, and we train the AI block on top of driving license as a document set. So that is what repurpose is all about. So given the scope of the problem, we plug in our AI block, give a meaningful structure to it, and that is what comes out as a solution. Now, what are the advantages of having a solution like this or incorporating AI block within an enterprise setup? It helps in training the system quickly. It helps in having a higher processing power. And subsequently, it helps in verifying whether your data set, which has seen through an exception, can go through a verification process very easily and with ease. So that is how the intelligent function works within an enterprise setup, which we call as AI block. Now, how we do it? So imagine there is, again, I'm going into supply chain. So let's say you have unclassified procurement data, which is basically your unstructured data with different tables. So one is, let's say, simply your procurement data, where you know from which vendor, what quantity, which date, what location you have procured the goods. Now, using that data, we plug in our AI block. Now, we, as part of the active learning process, so in active learning, what happens is we pass on this data set to a system where we create the model for this. Now, this model is what we call as the AI block. Now, within the AI block, once we pass on the subsequent data, which is as part of, let's say, the training. So let's say you have 10 different rows within this unclassified procurement data, and it's in an Excel sheet. You have passed on the first, you have trained the system with the first row, second row. Subsequently, you're passing on the And once your before your KYC gets processed, what they do is at whatever stage you would have shown your PAN or Aadhaar, during that stage, they take a snapshot. And that is what will be taken as an input to your document processing AI block, which will process or for extracting the essential details from a PAN card. So let's say the essential details, Aadhaar's name, and subsequently, if required, there could be a signature match also with the account opening form. So this is exactly how we have understood that, you know, the different value chain in terms of businesses can be broken down in a very simplistic manner, and we can take one problem at a time and we can address that. Similarly, there is a ATM-based reconciliation which can be done. So let's say sitting in one corner, a bank can actually do a reconciliation, three-way reconciliation, we call it. Most of the banks, they give out money to a third-party custodian to load the amount in the various ATMs across, let's say, across their region of operation or wherever their ATMs are. Now, what happens is these custodians, they in turn charge the bank for the services that they have provided at the end of the month. Now the bank, they would not be accounting every day, and at the end of the month, they will find some discrepancy. Now it's very difficult to account for what was the reason for the discrepancy. Now what we did is we plugged in our AI block within the banking, within the bank's data center, wherever they had a connectivity to all these ATM logs. And from the log, we are able to understand how much money couldn't be disbursed because of some error in the ATM machines, and how much money was actually loaded and what was already lying. Every day, reconciliation with what slip or what note was passed on by the custodian versus what was the ledger, banking ledger saying at that point of time, with the banking statement which the custodian had shared or the note which the custodian had shared. So this three-way reconciliation helps bank to account for its money and also to do an ATM reconciliation process. Similar way, we have also created a data-driven lending mechanism. So let's say any company, now the problem statement here is very simple. Any company which goes through a phase where they are offering loan. So what happens is a customer will apply for this loan, and as part of the processing, these companies have to spend more than 1,000 rupees to process a loan document, because just the cost of getting a CIBIL score to be able to process this is 250 rupees. Now, what we created is we took in the data through these various access points. So let's say if this company has given a is offering loan via mobile app. So what we did is we are taking in data from various means. So one of the means is through the mobile itself, through the GPS data. The other is the macro and the micro data, which we are able to capture. This is the location of the person. So let's say the person is in Gujarat, which happens to be among the top 5 states. So taking the inflation and the WPI index of India, taking all these factors into consideration, we have created a parallel scoring mechanism similar to CIBIL, which will make banks or such organizations independent to come out with their own alternative credit scoring mechanism. Yeah. So similar way, we have understood that there is a value chain in healthcare also, which starts from right from a clinical visit to a patient registration. Subsequently, there is a medical record which gets maintained, and there is a scheduling process when the patient actually opts for an appointment. And then there is a final stage, which is around billing or what we call as revenue cycle management for that particular patient. Now, what we have understood is if I just take the example of a patient journey, this is how a patient onboarding or an appointment scheduling journey will look like. Now, at each stage, there can be an automation. Now, unfortunately, in India, the healthcare system is not that, structured. So we are working on this sort of a model only in US, where there are different healthcare service providers, and also EHR. The full form is Electronic Health Record Service Providers. So the likes of companies like Athena Health, and then you have Epic. Epic happens to be the number one company who actually maintain the records of the customer. So they provide the software where the hospitals and all these clinics, they are maintaining the record of their patients. So that can eventually be automated. So you can imagine 10 years down the line, you will find that almost all shops or all such healthcare shops within US will get automated, and you will not find what we call as a medical representative or a compounder, what we call as in plain terms. And it will be all self-service based clinics and hospitals. And that is the idea with which automation is working towards. I'll not go in depth into this life cycle, but this is just in terms of sketching how we are trying to address the problem by understanding the value chain. Similarly, in rural and agro business, what we have understood is the real need of the farmer. Any business problem comes from the need of the business user. So instead of just applying blindly, let me apply AI because it's very fancy. That is not what we are looking to do. What we are trying to achieve here, and let me draw an analogy here in terms of the rural banking space. Here, the real idea is what is important for a farmer. And if you ask any technology company, they will be talking about, they should be getting this app to work, and that is the real value. No. The real value for a farmer is money. He needs money to buy his seeds. He needs money to buy his equipment. He needs money to get crops irrigated. So the right sort of essentials, which come as part of the value chain financing. So seeds, water, fertilizer, transportation, animal fodder to take care of his livestock. And that is the real need. So imagine the Maslow's need hierarchy theory. What is the basic need of any individual? It is what we call as in real terms as roti, kapda and makan. So that is essentially what is required for a farmer. He requires money. He doesn't bother that you are giving an access point or a mobile journey where, he is coming in, he is signing up, he is getting 100 rupees. And you have scaled it up in the sense that if he is referring to different people, he is getting money for that. No, what he is essentially worried about is, can he get enough money so as to be able to buy seeds and sow the seeds at the right time? And that is what is his real worry. So taking that into consideration, currently we are working with a big company, which is IFFCO Kisan. And we are helping them to understand that the real need of farmer is, can he get the basic need, which is money, and what all things money can buy him to be successful. The success of a farmer is considered by how much crop he can grow, what is his yield, how much his livestock are producing, and then eventually he has to counter against the risk. His risk is, let's say, the monsoon fails, or let's say there is a disease which hits his livestock. So that is where an insurance company will come in. Now, the first part could be through the value chain financing, or the essential needs could be through a bank or an NBFC. The risk can be covered by an insurance company. And what enables these two people, the insurance company and the NBFC or the banking partner, to enable and to understand to which farmer I can give how much as a layout or as money for them to use for the various financing that they have. So that is through a data-driven lending mechanism again. So given what the farmer is growing, how much land he has, there are various parameters for a farmer. How much livestock he has, how many people are actually working in his company, and how much is his actual dependency? So you have, in balance sheet, you have asset versus liability. His stocks are his asset, but the fodder is a liability. So taking a measure of that, what we have done is, again, there is a CIBIL score, CIBIL-like score, which is a farmer credit score, which we call as, which can be provided to each of the farmers. And that will help the insurance company to insure for his crop. That will provide it the right sort of sources or the data points for a bank to give out loan for seeds, water, fertilizer, transportation, and other means. And similarly, there can be, again, a banking or an NBFC partner which can do the structural financing around farming, warehousing, and different transportation-related finances. So this is the real thing, and the opportunity is huge because almost 31% of the global population is unbanked at this point of time. Leave the farmer. It's the net population that is unbanked and is going through an economic divide in the society because of this imbalance in. And most of this is happening, most of these initiatives are happening in countries like India, Africa, Latin America. These are the places because Europe has already seen the growth of this. Thanks to the cooperative banking movement in Europe, which was led by Raiffeisen in the late, in the 1950s. In fact, the real revolution happened in the around 1893 is when Raiffeisen came into picture in Austria, and that is how they did this. But similar thing, I am glad that the Indian government is actually taking a lot of initiatives to bring in farmer as part of the financial inclusion process and the banking process. So that is how we are looking to do. Now, because of positive time, I will not go into the value chain, but this is the value chain which we have understood for insurance, where right from customer acquisition to underwriting an insurance to the claims part of the insurance and then billing. All this can be actually automated, but not 100%. We are not never talking about 100% automation. What we are saying is there has to be a human in the loop at all times. Because given that your data set with which you have trained your model, that can change, or let's say there can be exceptions to the system because of various factors, because of the customer acquisition journey being different, or because of how you are taking in the data set. That's why it's important to understand that the right mix in terms of automation and human in the loop is 80-20, which is the Pareto principle. So 80% automation, you can go with 80% automation, but 20% has to be always human in the loop. This for a very mature system. Initially, it could be, 60 to 70 or even 60 to 55% automation, the rest part human in the loop. But that doesn't help the company to scale up. So there is the right sort of balance which has to go through. Now, I'll not go into the engagement model. This is typically how we do. But tell you that why AI block and how it helps. So AI block actually helps in terms of strategizing and planning. Because remember, as I had mentioned, you don't have to essentially move any of the piece which is already existing within your system. You just have to plug it and it will address that particular problem and it will not mess with the other areas within, let's say, if it is a supply chain use case, it will just address that particular problem and not disturb the ecosystem or your current process. So essentially what it is providing through what we are doing through AI block is an intelligent automation journey, which is more like an advisory solution because we are doing process mining and doing the scope of that. We are actually creating a feasibility analysis for ourselves, whether and what should be the percentage of automation which the company can go about. And it is eventually helping the company to standardize its process because they are learning about their own processes, which they were doing all this time very unconsciously. The third aspect is it helps to assess that within a customer journey, what is the amount of automation and how the human in the loop is eventually able to deliver the right sort of success to the business. Now, this customer journey assessment, you can actually imagine that within the whole scale, how much of it is really automated will be determined by the part which is run by just the AI block. So let's say from, if I take the example of KYC, right from taking the document till processing it, it's all AI block, but there are certain elements like let's say scanning of the document or the upload of the document by a customer. That is manual, right? But it's driven through a customer. So taking that part out together with, you know, the end journey, which could be like also exceptions. This will help to understand what is the broad role of AI block. And that is what we call as AI block assessment. Subsequently, we have given this for two managed services like Wipro, Capgemini. We are looking for such companies which are handling the backend processes for big healthcare companies and insurance companies and banking players to be able to run these AI blocks in their managed services space for these companies and to provide the right sort of outcome within the stipulated time that they have already committed to in terms of SLA. Now, this we are endorsing more on the cloud because most of the businesses would like to have a very thin client which is running on the cloud and to leverage on cloud computing. So that is the essential thing which we are moving instead of providing an on-prem. Because with on-prem, there are a lot of hassles, primarily in terms of procuring the server. You bear the cost of the resources who are actually managing this server. There is a huge infrastructure cost. But at the same time, there are regulations. So certain banks and insurance companies, they would like to have an on-prem setup. And then with certain, I would say, certain comfort and regulations and let's say framework which have come along, like the vulnerability or the penetration testing, which is done by third-party auditing companies, they would like to go to a more hybrid solution, I would say. So, but still, there is a lot of pushback and cloud-based solutions, 100% cloud-based solutions have not gained so much traction, especially with banks, insurance companies, and healthcare companies. But with managed services, as in back office companies, companies who are running the back office shows or the BPO companies, they are able to adopt because for them, the real thing is efficiency and how quickly they can deliver because cost is a big aspect for them. So these are the vital parameters on which we are banking. We say that, you know, with AI block, we are able to provide 80% automation. And that is what the human in the loop, the rest will be taken care by the human in the loop. And this leads to innovation because essentially when companies become more cognizant about their own processes, they do something more than what is already there and that helps them to innovate. And at the same time, it's a very modular structure because you are addressing one problem at a time and the same problem can also be scaled up. And it helps to bring in quality automation because you have understood and you are cognizant now of your process. So it helps to leverage and let's say any additional processes which have to be adopted, the turnaround time for that reduces because you are more confident about your existing process. What it brings along is it improves the precision for the business. It helps the business to be more confident about what it is doing. And it brings in economies of scale and in terms of pricing. These are some of the partners and client. So very quickly, before I take in questions, I just had one thing to share. So how we bootstrap, it's actually a journey. And this is very important. So the whole idea of this presentation, which I wanted to do, was to understand that, you know, given a particular problem, how we can actually make it simple or understand it from a very simplistic view and then address it by considering that problem as a standalone problem and not the whole problem which is there inside that larger set, which is the problem statement itself. So how we have bootstrapped it is a real story. So in vertical, there is a concept of vertical startup, which comes from lean manufacturing, which is about, let's say, so even I have endorsed it in many places. This concept is about GPDS, which is called as, so the real thing is, the first thing, if you are not looking to take in investor funding, it is about looking to grow your list. So by growing your list, what it means is essentially, let's say if I am selling a solution, which is, so let's say I am selling cars, right? So the first idea, or let's say, let me take the example, which is more realistic nowadays, which is COVID-19, right? So let's say a company would like to launch a new vaccine. Now, to launch a new vaccine, what you need to do? You need to have a ready base of customers who are willing to buy the product. Because essentially, you will not go to your supply chain and to start manufacturing those products. And at the end of the day, you will find that suddenly your demand for that vaccine has gone. So what essentially you do, you grow your list. That is what is the acronym G. By growing your list, it means you name out or you create your sales pipeline, including your customer, which could be B2C or government, whosoever is willing to buy your vaccine. Now, to do that, what you have to do is you have to go to P. So GPDS, P stands for pre-sell. So what you essentially you have to do is you have to pre-sell. You have to say that my vaccine has X percentage efficacy. My vaccine will be able to create the antibodies within 4 months. And that is what is able, what is helping you to pre-sell the idea. So you pre-sell the idea. In product, for a product company, it is also about creating an MVP. So what you do is you utilize your existing resource and you say, we have done a similar thing for XYZ company. And this is how it looks like. We can repurpose this and create the same thing for you. So that is about pre-sell. Then you go to D, which is develop. Once you have pre-sold, let's say you have sold to XYZ number of people. Now there, what happens is you already have a list of people who are willing to pay you. You have countered the risk of defaulting on payment or people who will, or a product which will not be viable when you actually launch it, right? So the third thing is that you essentially have to develop and then you scale. So that is GPDS. You scale because you have developed and now you know that the initial list of people are the minimum customers whom you can reach out. From there, you can only scale up. So that is the overall, you know, view in terms of how vertical startup works. And this comes from the manufacturing domain. So I'm sorry, I took a bit of time, but you know, this was important as an analogy. So I had kept initially at least 15 to 20 minutes for Q&A, but that's it from my side, Anupam from Obvious.
Thank you, sir. It was really a wonderful session.
Thanks, pleasure.
So, there is one question in the chat box from Diwali Kure. Can you give some excellent examples relevant to real world integration of AI?
Okay, sure. So, let me show over a video that will give a better idea. So this is what something which we did for Concentrix, which is again a BPO player. So within the, now the use case here was Concentrix, for them the problem statement was for one invoice, a person or an FT, which is a full-time employee, was taking 40 minutes to process a single invoice because there are different parameters, almost like 9 to 10 parameters, which he has to check across 3 different systems. So that is like 9 parameters cross 3. Because all these parameters will be having the same the same values, they have to look for the same values across three systems. So it's 27 data points eventually, because you are checking at all these 27 places. Now, the real thing which we provided them was to be able, a mechanism using AI block, using which they can capture, recognize, classify. So let's say you have different invoices. Now, one could be an invoice which is for a restaurant, or the other one could be an invoice which is from your procurement, which is, let's say, a good which you have procured from another company. So now you would like to treat all these invoices differently, right? So there is a classification leg. So being able to just recognize the pattern and the layout within a invoice, we are able to classify based on the content and the rules which are set, and also the images. Now, once we do this, we actually validate it with the model which is there. And then finally, we verify, and if it requires, there could be a downstream or an upstream integration with the various systems which are there. Now, let me show the real, with less of talk, let me just show how this invoice looked like. Now, this is a real example of AI. So this was a typical invoice which was there. Now, within this invoice, there is a lot of noise. Because by noise, I mean there is a lot of cluttering of data, and it's very low on resolution. So the general DPI or what we say as the resolution, which we consider, it's not visible. Somebody has mentioned it's not visible. Let me know if it's visible or not.
Yes, sir. It's not visible.
Oh, is it? Just a moment. Sorry, I was talking all the time. Now it should be. Thank you. Sorry. So this is how their typical invoice looked like. Now this is a typical case of document processing. In this, you'll find the resolution is very low and there is a lot of cluttering of data. Here, what we did was we helped the business, and there could be multiple invoices. So you'll find that we help them to do cloud computing. So here there are four different tabs opened up. So you can eventually, the same FTE can upload all these documents at the same time, or he can just do a bulk upload of all of them and can process it. So this is a real world example of AI put to document processing, because essentially what's happening is each and every time you pass on the different document, the system is able to learn on its own which part to extract and what is. So just as a corollary, I don't know how many of you might be familiar with this, but in business logic, what we call these fields which we have extracted, these are called as region of interest or field of interest. So we don't do OCR. Instead, what we do is we use object detection to kind of mark those fields as part of the learning instance. So we say that billing information is in this part of the invoice, and that is what has to be captured. And once we have trained, let's say the initial set of documents, it could be 100 or 200 set of documents, we never ask companies for whom we are creating this model for the number of documents, but we say, share as many variations as possible. Then what happens is, let's say if they want to process 1,000 documents, that is exactly what can be processed in this manner. So it's part of AI plus machine learning, because you are learning in terms of the historical data as well. And post this, so this has 80%, again, 80% automation, 20% human in the loop. So their ask was that after extraction, there should be an XML which can be uploaded and sent to their downstream system. This is the XML which will come along and can be submitted to their downstream system. Similar way, and I can share a link. There is a video KYC example also. So like that, there are a lot of examples. I can share my company's YouTube channel as well. By the way, currently I also have openings on the, so if professors can endorse, I have openings essentially on the technical side, looking for front end as well as back end developers on AI and machine learning. So this is where the XML was uploaded with the essential details. The details got fetched on its own by just reading the XML's name. This helps, I hope. There were some more queries, I think.
There is one question from Nasir Drarani. What is the difference between Industry 4.0 and intelligent automation industry?
So, a lot of people talk about Industry 4.0, but Industry 4.0 will take a lot of time to actually evolve. But in terms of the current scope of things, just adopting intelligent automation is what is currently something which companies are looking forward to. Because essentially, when you talk about 4.0, it is all about companies being able to understand and adopt AI on its own. But that adoption will only happen if you are able to take in AI and may incorporate it in the right sort of sense within your use cases or your business cases. So that is important. So 4.0 is way ahead, although a lot of companies are talking about it. But if you say even 1.0, AI 1.0, how much of the industry has adopted? It's something which is still questionable, because I have literally banged my head trying to help cooperative banks to adopt AI and machine learning as part of the process. So I don't endorse 4.0, and it's going to take a lot of time for the industry to evolve. But yeah, AI again has a lot of drawbacks also, because people use it in the wrong sense and not because it has a real drawback of its own. So we should use it in a more justifiable manner, and not for, getting eyes. So, for uploading the bill on system, is there any pre...
There is one question from Pranita Mahajan.
Yeah.
What is the difference between AI and machine learning from technology domain and application domain point of view?
Okay, I think machine learning and data science. So, machine learning and data science, so one is about the understanding of data. So when you know how a data is structured, you will be able to understand how to represent that data. And that is what we call as data visualization. So that is the study which comes along data science. But essentially, machine learning is a bit different. So machine learning, you can consider is a parallel domain where certain things can overlap with data science, but essentially, within machine learning, what happens is the understanding of the data and the implication of the data will help you to feed the data to a machine-based algorithm. So let's say, if I take an example, you have the KYC data for all different set of customers in the last 1 month. Now, if you want to see what all customers can be actually flagged as high-risk customers, just by the customer name. So either you see a Bin Laden or that sort of a string there. So you can, what you can do is you can actually put in through the idea that if there is a word Bin Laden, I'll feed to my system that this is a high-risk customer, right? Now that can easily be done by data science, because essentially you just have to look for that particular string and you can feed your system. But machine learning, just let me take this example and draw the analogy of machine learning. In machine learning, what happens is, let's say you have done it on month one and you are saying that Bin Laden should be put as part of high-risk customer. You have done that. Now in month two, when you go, you have found that based on your previous experience, that customer has already been doing a transaction and the machine or the bank has taken a decision that not all bin Ladens are supposed to be flagged. So there, what it does is the machine learns, or the algorithm learns based on the historical data that not all bin Laden, but you need something more than that. You need, let's say, also the amount to determine whether there was a discrepancy. So let's say the customer has always been having an average transaction of $10,000 to $20,000. But suddenly there is a 1 million transaction. That will be part of the machine learning thing, which will say that based on the business logic and the understanding over the last few months, this is a deviation. So that is how the machine will learn. So it's more about historical data. While in data science, you don't take consideration of the historical data that often. So that is the typical differentiation in terms of technology as well as the domain. I hope that explains.
There is one more question. For uploading a bid or a bill on a system, is there any pre-attributes or fixed?
Yeah, generally with a mature system, and the data set, if we have done a similar thing already, so like let's say we did a exercise for Mother Dairy in Delhi NCR, and there we have understood that there are some 6 data points which will always be extracted from a bill, or let's say an electricity bill, I would say, and that can come as predefined attributes. But again, this is part of a template which can be provided. But if you want to define your own attributes, like let's say if barcode is generally considered as one of the attributes, but let's say your invoice doesn't have a barcode, but it has a Bharat QR code, then there are not many systems which are able to take care of that, because that comes with an encrypted 956 character format. So, but even that can be incorporated. So yeah, it has predefined, but then you can customize your own.
Thank you, sir.
The next speaker is going to get angry on me. we are short on time. Yeah.
Participants, if you have any questions, you can put in the chat box or you can unmute yourself also.
Let me pass on my email ID also. I'll be open to any questions. And also to any, any of the references which can be there for the opportunities that I have. Amrita, there is a query around a feedback link.
Yes, sir. That is basically on the session. Okay.
Sure. Okay.
So we will. I will.